X, the research, part four. We've gone over the book by Douglas Axe, Undeniable, subtitled How Biology Confirms Our Intuition That Life is Designed, published this year by HarperCollins. And the question arises, where does Axe get the confidence to say that we should believe our design intuition and ignore the scientific consensus? And we've gone over three of those research papers, one by Axe in 2000, published in the peer-reviewed literature from Oxford University as a postdoctorate. Another one by Axe started at Oxford, but having to be finished at the Bobram Institute Structural Biology Unit in Cambridge, near Oxford, and noticeable, again, it's published in the Journal of Molecular Biology. Then we have looked at a couple of papers. One, a theoretical one by Axe in 2010 about the limits of complex adaptation, and the other one by Gager and Axe working together, who noted that getting from one enzyme to another required more than that limit, which means that you can't do it in any kind of reasonable evolutionary time, not without amazing coincidences which start to border on, and some would say, fade into miraculous. And then today, we're going to discuss a paper written by Gager and Associates, also in 2010, obviously with some at least input from the knowledge that Douglas Axe had, but this time without him in the authorship. And it's called Reductive Evolution Can Prevent Populations from Taking Simple Adaptive Paths to High Fitness. And this one, again, has to be published in the ID-friendly literature, because the ID-unfriendly literature is not friendly to the conclusions. But so that's the paper we're going to be talking about today. To go through the abstract and then to try to flesh it out, new functions requiring multiple mutations, and we're going to be only talking about two mutations, are thought to be evolutionarily feasible if they can be achieved by means of adaptive paths, successions of simple adaptations, each involving a single mutation. That is, B is better than A, C is better than B, D is better than C, and so forth until you finally get to the top. The presence or absence of these adaptive paths to new function therefore constrain what can evolve. But since emerging functions may require costly overexpression to improve fitness, and we'll unpack that in a little while, it is also possible for reductive, that is, cost-cutting mutations that eliminate overexpression to be adaptive. Consequently, the relative abundance of these kinds of adaptive paths, constructive paths leading to new function versus reductive paths that increase metabolic efficiency, is an important evolutionary constraint. To study the impact of this constraint, we observe the paths actually taken during long-term laboratory evolution of an Escherichia coli strain carrying a doubly mutated tryptophan A gene. The presence of these two mutations prevents tryptophan biosynthesis. One of the mutations is partially inactivating, while the other is fully inactivating, thus permitting a two-step adaptive path to full tryptophan biosynthesis. Despite the theoretical existence of this short adaptive path to high fitness, we're only talking two steps. Multiple independent lines grown in tryptophan-limiting liquid culture failed to take it. That is, it didn't happen. Instead, cells consistently required mutations that reduced expression of the double mutant tryptophan A gene. Our results show that competition between reductive and constructive paths may significantly decrease the likelihood that a particular constructive path will be taken. This finding has particular significance for models of gene recruitment, since weak new functions are likely to require costly overexpression in order to improve fitness. If reductive cost-cutting mutations are more abundant than mutations that convert or improve function, recruitment may be unlikely even in cases where a short adaptive path, in this case two steps, exists. Now, the paper itself, and again, I'm not going to read you the whole paper, but the key portions of it. Introduction, according to standard evolutionary theory, every adaptation, even the most sophisticated, is a product of a series of simple adaptive steps. Adaptive steps are thought typically to involve a single mutation. Those steps requiring two independent mutations may also be feasible under some circumstances. And notice that's just not what they're saying. They have experimental proof to back it up. Whether by single mutations or double mutations, though, as long as each step of an adaptive path is both feasible and beneficial, it is commonly assumed that the path will be followed. Commonly assumed, but as we shall find out, incorrect. However, the theoretical existence of an adaptive path to new function does not guarantee that it will be taken. If only one path leads to a particular highly beneficial multi-step adaptation, but many competing paths end in other less beneficial local fitness optima, but still beneficial, the likelihood of taking the path to the multi-step adaptation would be severely reduced. Less beneficial but competing paths would potentially include adaptive mutations that reduce metabolic costs by down-regulating or deleting non-functional genes, or perhaps very poorly functional genes. If these reductive or cost-cutting mutations are sufficiently numerous, then adaptations that are theoretically possible, because the paths to construct them exist, may nonetheless be, in practice, unattainable. This scenario is relevant to the origin of new genes. Most genes are thought to have originated by a process of gene duplication and divergent evolution leading to new function. The gene duplicates, one keeps doing the old thing, the new one gets the old thing destroyed and some new process created. Typically, experimental studies of this process look for genes whose products are able to metabolize a new compound or replace a missing function. But since the recruited gene product often performs its new function very poorly, it is likely to require overexpression to have selective benefit. If you need a gene, but your enzyme only works 1/100th as well, then you need 100 times as much to get the same benefit. And of course, if it's 1,000 or 10,000 times as poor, then you need 10,000 times to get the same benefit. And so overexpression may be helpful in that situation. This means that the benefit comes with a metabolic cost. Furthermore, if a duplicate gene requires modification in order to provide the new function, the cost will be present before the functional benefit emerges. This is the problem. They're technically maladaptive when they start. Since early reductive mutations also confer a benefit in such cases, they may sweep the population, effectively preventing complex adaptation by diverting the population into evolutionary dead ends. To test whether or not reductive paths can prevent evolution along a short constructive path, we engineered a bacterial strain in which both types of path are present. Escherichia coli cells, lacking the chromosomal tryptophan BA genes, in case you're wondering, tryptophan, the last enzyme, has a part B and a part A. We're going to see a little bit of that in a minute. And so the tryptophan A is the part they're going to mess up. We're given highly expressed plasmid-borne copies of tryptophan CBA with two specified point mutations introduced into tryptophan A. One of these mutations is partially inactivating, the other fully inactivating. Under conditions of limiting tryptophan, reversion of the completely inactivating mutation should slightly enhance fitness by restoring partial tryptophan A activity. Reversion at the second site would then restore the enzyme's function completely, greatly increasing fitness. The high level of expression of the plasmid-borne tryptophan CBA genes carries a significant metabolic cost, though, which means that the cells grown under conditions of limiting tryptophan may potentially benefit either by taking the constructive path to full tryptophan proficiency or by taking any of the various reductive paths that permit more efficient use of the limited tryptophan in the medium. You have something that's overproducing a protein. It doesn't really do anything. Okay, you can either make the protein to where it does something, or you can shut off the protein producing mechanism entirely, and either one of those will give the bacterium an advantage. The one by producing more tryptophan, the other one by not wasting tryptophan on proteins that don't really do anything. Results: engineering an adaptive path. Tryptophan synthesis is a multimeric enzyme, multiple parts, composed of two alpha subunits, the protein product of tryptophan A gene, and two beta subunits, the protein product of tryptophan B gene. In figure one, which you'll see in a minute, the enzyme as a whole catalyzes the last two steps in the biosynthesis of tryptophan. And here is the, well, we'll see in a minute the actual pathway. There's indole that's attached to phosphoryl glycerin or glyceraldehyde, and which can be used in metabolism. In fact, is part of the glycolytic cycle. And the idea is you cleave this, and then this indole part right here goes down a special tube to the other to the inside of the beta unit, where that is combined with amino acid serine. Water is taken away, and it becomes tryptophan. And that's the last two steps of the metabolic pathway to get to tryptophan. It's interesting that there's not only is required that you have these two enzymes, but you also have this little tube. And there's the tryptophan precursor right there. And here are the two amino acid residues that they're going to change. You change them, and it no longer produces the indole that can be used to make tryptophan. Each alpha unit subunit cleaves indole 3 glycerol phosphate to form indole and glyceraldehyde 3 phosphate. We'll see figure 2 in a minute. The indole is then channeled along a 25 angstrom diameter tunnel to a corresponding active site in the beta dimer, where it is combined with L-serine to make L-tryptophan. Previous workers have reported a number of chromosomal null mutants for tryptophan A, including the mutations E49V, which is taking glutamic acid and turning it into a valine, or D60N, which takes an aspartic acid and turns it into asparagine. And there's some references on that. And here's the chemical reaction that happens. It cleaves it right there, puts an OH on this and a hydrogen on this, and then this indole is the one that's going to travel through the tube to be used at the other end. Whereas the glyceraldehyde 3-phosphate just goes into the Krebs cycle as usual. We introduce these two mutations individually into the tryptophan A gene of plasma WS1. So they picked plasma WS1 and they made it, but with a couple of either one or two of these two mutations in there. Takes some careful plotting to get it done, but it can be done. By single site directed mutagenesis, and then determined the phenotype they conferred on the tryptophan E. coli host, and that's just a strain number. Now, so basically the phenotype is, what does it actually do? Does it metabolize tryptophan? Can it make its own? As expected, the strain carrying the tryptophan A allele with the single E49V mutation, this allele, they have their own designation in the paper, which is technically not perfectly correct, but makes it easier to understand. We'll call that the single glutamic acid one, was unable to grow on tryptophan-free minimal agar. It can't grow without tryptophan because it can't make its own. The strain carrying the tryptophan A D60N, which is the one that goes from asparagine to aspartic acid, so the asparagine mutation allele, however, proved to be weakly tryptophan positive. That is, it could grow without tryptophan. Slowly, but it could do it. With visible growth appearing after 1 week on minimal agar, even though, minimal agar meaning agar without tryptophan in it, even though this mutation was originally identified as null. They didn't think it grew, but, you know, if you look very, very closely, yes, it can grow a little bit. The parent plasmid PWS1 is known to direct substantial overexpression of the tryptophan CBA genes, produces too much of it, such that their products represent about 15% of the total soluble protein. So the organism is wasting 15% of the protein on this useless enzyme. Apparently, the mutant A subunit, tryptophan A asparagine, has sufficient activity to permit growth when present in large amounts. That tryptophan A asparagine is weakly active is further supported by the observation that crystallized tryptophan A, that is, you take the protein and you just crystallize it, is able to cleave its substrate indole 3 glycerol phosphate at room temperature, albeit very slowly. So it can actually work, it just doesn't work very well. Strains carrying either tryptophan AE49V or tryptophan A aspartic acid readily revert to tryptophan ordinary, typically yielding 3 to 7 revertants from an overnight culture of about a billion cells per milliliter. So they basically, you culture this stuff, and it actually does produce a few mutations that are back mutations, if you want to call them that. Okay. The reversion rates were estimated to be 1.1 times 10 to the minus 8 and 0.8 times 10 to the minus 8, respectively, which is about the mutation rate you expect in normal cells. Maybe a little tiny bit more, but not much, as determined by fluctuation tests. And, so they actually checked it out. Based on the phenotypes of strains carrying tryptophan AE49V, the glutamic acid one or the aspartic acid one, we inferred that a strain carrying the double mutation with both aspartic and glutamic acid should be able to acquire full tryptophan biosynthesis by this simple adaptive path. You start out with the double mutant, then you go to the aspartic mutant, which metabolizes tryptophan but not very well, and then you should go to the regular tryptophan with the back mutations having been corrected. The first step, reversion of the glutamic acid, would produce the weak tryptophan phenotype of the aspartic acid one, which presumably carries a fitness advantage relative to the initial tryptophan double mutant strain because it can actually metabolize other things into tryptophan. That selective advantage should allow the tryptophan A aspartic acid change allele to become fixed, at which point the wild-type tryptophan A revertant would soon follow and, based on its large fitness advantage, quickly overtake the culture. Evolution in serial and batch cultures. The strain carrying the double mutant allele was used to establish several liquid cultures for growth and evolution under tryptophan-limiting conditions. That means that there's a little tiny bit of tryptophan, but not very much. And when the cells ran out of tryptophan, they quit growing. None of these cultures, whether grown in batches or propagated by serial transfer, acquired the fully tryptophan-positive phenotype. Nothing went through the double mutation, period. Nor did they appear to have acquired the weakly tryptophan-positive phenotype, only with the aspartic acid, based on samples screened on solid medium. This is surprising in view of the scale of the experiment, some serial cultures having been propagated for 9,000 plus generations and a total of about a trillion cells having been the opportunity to revert either in serial or batch cultures. In contrast, batches inoculated with the single strain with glutamic acid only yielded about 10 to the 4th to 10 to the 5th tryptophan positive revertants per milliliter after 4 days of growth. They really revert well. And serial cultures of either that strain or the aspartic acid one become completely tryptophan positive within 5 transfers. That is to say, once the bacterium is able to make its own tryptophan, it grows like crazy in this tryptophan-limiting broth. To rule out the possibility that some unknown defect outside the tryptophan, the double allele, in the original construct prevented reversion, we remade this plasmid by replacing the wild-type tryptophan A with a freshly prepared PWS1 with the mutant, the double mutant. The remade plasmid was then used to establish 12 new lines. All of these lines also failed to evolve the tryptophan-positive phenotype during 500 generations of serial culture in tryptophan-limiting liquid medium. Now, the question is, why did it not work? Evolution in solid culture. The above experiments were all done in tryptophan-limiting liquid cultures, providing a uniform environment in which all cells compete with each other. In that environment, cells reach stationary phase between 15 and 18 hours after inoculation. They grow and they grow and they grow and they run out of stuff and they stop growing, depending on their doubling times. Thus, under our conditions of liquid serial transfer, the cells typically spent between 6 and 9 hours in stationary phase prior to transfer to a new, with a little extra more tryptophan. Because starvation is known to increase mutation rates in bacteria, this non-growing phase may enhance evolution. In contrast, cells grown in solid culture compete for nutrients only with their nearest neighbors, rather than with the entire culture, enabling microenvironments to develop. A single weakly tryptophan-positive revertant might be able to survive and reproduce enough to appear as a colony on agar, even though unable to compete in liquid culture. By the way, these are smelly cultures. They smell like poop. We therefore looked for revertance in cultures grown on small solid medium. We kept the plates for 3 weeks at 37 degrees, that's human body temperature, that's why they picked that, to increase their time in stationary phase. We also varied both the selection conditions and the amount of growth on the plate by varying how much tryptophan and or glucose was added to the minimal agar medium. As expected, overall growth improved in a tryptophan-dependent manner. You give them more tryptophan, they grow better. Duh. But no reversion of the double mutant strain was detected. It just stayed that way. Whether on tryptophan-free or tryptophan-limiting medium, didn't matter what you put it in, even with prolonged incubation. Control cultures grown from the single mutant strains reverted easily and with increasing frequency under the same conditions. That is to say, if you have either single mutant, the aspartic acid or the glutamic acid, didn't matter, they would revert to normal. But the double mutant just didn't do it. Finally, we tested the effect of a mutator strain on reversion to tryptophan positivity. We transduced a mismatch repair mutation. That is, there's an E. coli without the proper enzyme. It has an enzyme that doesn't really do what it's supposed to, and it doesn't repair properly into the bacterial strain host, and then compared the reversion rates for the glutamic acid and the aspartic acid plasmids in host strains with and without the mutator allele. Cells with the glutamic acid strain in a mutant H background showed a fivefold increase in reversion rate relative to the standard one. So if you make more mutations that get in, it tends to revert faster to the wild type, so to speak. It's not technically wild type because you have the enzyme on a plasmid instead of in the DNA of the bacterium itself. Similarly, the reversion rate for tryptophan aspartic acid in a mutant H background increased 20-fold compared to the other one. So as you can see, well, 5 versus 20, there's a slight difference in how well the trying to make mutations works, but it still happens much more frequently than just the old standard one. In spite of the increased level of mutation caused by that, there were no tryptophan-positive revertants of the double mutant strain were detected. After plating nearly 10 to the 11th, 100 billion cells to minimal agar. Assessing fitness, the two-step reversion shown above is only an adaptive path if both steps confer a selective advantage. Up to this point, we've demonstrated that the second step, reversion of the tryptophan A aspartic acid to normal, is adaptive. But we have only inferred it for the first step based on the weakly tryptophan-positive phenotype. You'd expect it to work better. Okay. To confirm that this first step is adaptive experimentally as opposed to theoretically, we conducted experiments to determine whether cells carrying the tryptophan A aspartic acid allele can, in fact, outcompete cells carrying the mutation when co-cultured under conditions of limiting tryptophan. Three lines of evidence indicate that they can. First, the strain carrying just the one is able to form colonies on tryptophan free agar in the presence of a million-fold excess of the double mutant strain. So with no reduction in plating efficiency. So it can actually grow where the other one won't. Second, the measuring doubling time for that mutant, the single mutation, is slightly shorter than for the double mutation. That is to say, it actually grows faster. You can show that. And finally, liquid co-cultures prepared in triplicate of the two freshly transformed strains with weak tryptophan positivity initially, in the minority, are 23% weak tryptophan on the average after 33 generations. In other words, it went from 1% of the culture to 23% of the culture, which means, yes, it does have an advantage. This represents a 22-fold increase, to be precise, in relative number of weak tryptophan-positive cells over the course of the cultures, further confirming that the above path, in fact, is adaptive. So, yes, it does outgrow the standard one. Not by very much, but enough to where you can detect it. Next, because plasmids are present in multiple copies within their bacterial host cells, we considered the possibility that a single revertant plasmid molecule might be insufficient to confer an advantage by itself. That is to say, if you have only one, instead of all four or five or ten, however many there are, maybe it just isn't good enough. Or the advantage might be too slight to overcome the stochastic aspects. That's just random chance variations of plasmid replication. To rule out this possibility, we prepared competent tryptophan negative cells carrying the double mutation and transformed these with either PWSI or plasmid, and then plated them on tryptophan-free agar. So they put in the wild-type stuff with too few. We recovered fully tryptophan-positive cultures from PWS1. That's the original plasmid transformed cells, and weak tryptophan positive colonies from the 213 transformed cells. That's the only aspartic acid one, defective one. In a DNA concentration dependent manner, even at less than one transforming plasmid per competent cell. So you couldn't collect them all into one. Control cultures of the deficient one that had received no DNA showed no growth of any kind on tryptophan-free agar. So, yes, it does work a little bit. Skipping over a paragraph. Finally, we wanted to establish that the failure of the double mutant to revert to tryptophan A was not due to some general inability of the double mutant strain to adapt. To test this, we measured the growth rate in tryptophan-limiting liquid medium of sample populations taken over the course of the long-term serial culture and found that the strain's growth rate had doubled within 500 generations for reasons that are apparently not related to the plasmid at all. So yes, it does adapt, it just doesn't adapt here. This substantial fitness improvement clearly demonstrates the capacity of the double mutant strain to adapt. Explaining the adaptive changes. Well, why is this when it should work? The real reason for the failure of the double mutant strain to revert to tryptophan positive became clear when we analyzed the plasmids isolated from each of the original long-term serial transfer lines. Plasmid from line 1 had suffered a deletion elimination of the tryptophan A and tryptophan B genes. It just got cut out of the plasmid, the whole thing. Line 2 plasmid showed no size change on a gel, indicating less drastic change. When we replaced 2's tryptophan double mutant allele with the aspartic acid only allele and used this construct to transform the strain, the resulting strain was phenotypically tryptophan negative, even though it carries the tryptophan A gene, which should work a little bit. As a check, the double mutant allele of the ancestral unevolved plasmid was replaced in the same way with the tryptophan A D60N, resulting in a plasmid presumably identical to plasmid 213 that confers the weak positive tryptophan phenotype as expected. What is going on? It is like it doesn't actually work. Upon sequencing that plasmid from five clonal lines derived from evolved line 2 population, we discovered that each clone carried a single upstream mutation, an adenine going to cytosine transversion at nucleotide position 1584 in the standard nomenclature, which lies within the second codon of the TET open reading frame. This point mutation appears to have been fixed by the 500th generation. It happened very rapidly because it's present in the plasmid from a sister culture begun by splitting line 2 at that generation. And what happens basically is that they discovered that that A to C reduced the protein output by 80%. Just that one single mutation. And what that means is that instead of putting out 13% of the protein as this wasted stuff, you are now putting out 2.6%. That is, 10% of the protein has been cut down. You see? So now it doesn't put out as much protein, even though you still have the same old gene. At least it's not wasting all this protein in a totally useless product. Prevalence of reductive paths. The two lines discussed to this point, lines 1 and 2, both took reductive adaptive paths, one by cutting out the whole protein, one by putting in a mutation that reduced it. By deleting or reducing expression of their double E mutant alleles. To see whether this is typical, we examined 12 other long-term serial cultures of the double mutant strain that had failed to revert to tryptophan positivity. 11 out of the 12 of these evolved lines showed evidence of reduced tryptophan A expression in that their plasmids failed to confer the weak tryptophan positive phenotype after replacing double mutant with the single mutant one. Now, there's a note there. You're wondering, what about the 12th one? We were unable to test one line because it had undergone an extensive rearrangement, so it was hard to figure out how to change one into the other. But it probably also reduced it. They just can't prove it quite as easily. A combination of restrictive analysis and DNA sequencing showed that plasmids from five of the lines had gained insertion elements. Four had IS1 elements, and one had an IS2 element. That means they inserted one or two DNA bases in the plasmid, most often in the region of the TET promoter, which means it messes the whole thing up. It doesn't produce the protein because you've messed up the mechanism of producing it. The remaining six lines showed no detectable size difference or rearrangement, but presumably carry expression-reducing point mutations similar to the number two that we talked about. Discussion. In evaluating any evolutionary scenario, it is important to distinguish between what is theoretically possible and what is actually apt to occur. Because real adaptive landscapes, what happens in actual life, tend to be complex with many possible reductive paths as well as constructive paths. It is not enough to show that the individual steps of a particular path have a selective benefit, however small. What you also have to show is that each step is likely to be taken given the whole set of competing paths open to the organization, and that it won't step off onto another path. A number of authors have recognized the complexity of adaptive landscapes and have examined the impact of this on evolutionary trajectories, focusing on the importance of genetic interactions, or epistasis, as a limit to adaptation. About seven references there. Here we point out another potential factor, the cost of gene expression, that can significantly affect the likelihood of a simple two-step adaptive path being taken. We also highlight the effect of selective conditions on the outcome of particular evolutionary scenarios. Expression of non-functional DNA carries a measurable cost. You're wasting protein for no good reason. Indicative of this cost is the fact that functional systems no longer required for survival tend to be lost by reproductive evolution. For example, obligate parasitic and symbiotic bacteria commonly lose non-essential genetic information. And yeast cells quickly reduce expression of their mating genes, sometimes irreversibly, when grown under conditions of continual asexual propagation. This reductive evolution could be due to the cost of expression, the cost of replication, or a combination of these. It's as if, you know, you have a spare tire in your car. Well, if you never use it, sooner or later somebody says, what do we got this for? Toss it out. Consistent with these observations, our experiments show that overexpressed non-functional genes are subject to rapid reduction of expression under nutrient-limiting conditions. This reductive evolution does not appear to be due to the cost of replication, at least in our system, since only 1 out of 14 lines tested reduced expression by deleting the genes in question, and since cells without plasmid and cells carrying plasmid whose overexpression has been reduced grow at similar rates. You can have the DNA there. That doesn't really matter that much. What really matters in this situation is, are you producing all this protein for no good reason? That reductive evolution occurs is not surprising. What is surprising is how effectively such reductive evolution can block a short adaptive path to higher fitness, high fitness under nutrient-limiting conditions. Not only were the liquid cultures we examined unable to evolve the fully reverted tryptophan-positive phenotype, they were effectively blocked from taking even the first step towards full reversion. The measured reversion rate of tryptophan glutamic acid to the wild type is in the order of 1 in 10 to the 8. Yet we detected at most 1 tryptophan double mutant going to tryptophan single mutant aspartic acid reversion in liquid culture. And that wasn't actually in broth, that was on a plate maybe. Out of some 10 to the 12th trillion cells screened, this represents an apparent decrease of at least 4 orders of magnitude in reversion rate. You normally get to 1 in 10 to the 8th. Now we're talking 1 in 10 to the 12th. It could happen. The point of it is, this does not make things impossible, but what it does is it greatly increases the odds against it happening. We recognize that the kind of overexpression that we describe here is unlikely to be selected for or maintained by cells in nature because of its fitness cost. You don't usually see this in real life. However, this scenario is routinely adopted in studies of gene recruitment. What that means is, when they're testing to see if evolution could produce an enzyme, they usually introduce unnatural conditions. Think about that. However, this scenario is routinely adopted in studies of gene recruitment. The reason for this is not merely a case of experimental design. New gene functions arise by recruitment. Gene duplication followed by functional divergence are likely to be weak at first appearance, implying that overexpression may be necessary in order for them to improve fitness. You have to front load this stuff. Even promiscuous enzymes that naturally catalyze minor secondary reactions to some degree typically do not enable the secondary function to be selected without overexpression. And this is not just what they're saying. This is actually shown in experimental papers. As a consequence, most laboratory demonstrations of functional conversion in vivo rely on multi-copy plasmids and induced overexpression in order for the target function to be strong enough to be selected. This overexpression is often at levels similar to those in our study. The resulting metabolic costs are significant, but commonly overlooked when the implications for natural evolution are assessed. They're looking at these data through rose-colored glasses. For example, one study looked for multifunctional proteins that, when overexpressed, could rescue E. coli strains lacking metabolic enzymes. Out of 104 oxytrophic strains tested, 21 could be rescued by induced overexpression of one or more non-cognate genes, forming colonies after days to weeks at cultures on minimal medium. Had those rescued strains been grown in competition with a sister strain unhindered by overexpression and on nutrient limiting rather than completely minimal medium, it is likely that some, if not most, of the rescued strains would have fared poorly. Evolution doesn't work if you try it in real life. There's at least one example of promiscuous functional residue occurring without engineered overexpression. This is natural overexpression. McLaughlin and Copley, in reference 12, describe a mutation that improves the promiscuous function of an enzyme but dramatically impairs its primary function. Although functional trade-offs of this kind are typical in the studies of promiscuity, the new observation in this case was that the impairment triggered overexpression as a natural regulatory response. So, yes, they still had overexpression. It just happened to be that it was more natural, shall we say. The authors suggest that regulatory compensation like this may provide an evolutionarily significant way for mutant alleles to serve both their original function role and an emerging new role. Ah, we found a path for evolution. According to this hypothesis, the mutant allele would become fixed because of the new function, after which duplication of the allele would enable the two copies to diverge, one specializing in the new function and the other reverting to provide the original function with high proficiency. And I'm going to close it with that. My take on all this is the existence of adaptive pathways for evolution is often assumed by the following logic. The front end and the back end of the pathway exist. The two organisms are related evolutionarily, so the middle must exist and must be adaptive, because otherwise we wouldn't have gotten where we are. This is actually assuming the conclusion that evolution can do this. And it is possible that the pathway does not actually exist, or exist in such a fine way that it's not reasonable to assume that it would happen in nature. Gager et al. Showed that the above assumption is not always valid for experimental cases. We have seen the same phenomenon where adaptive mutations are mostly destructive. Those of you who've been around long enough may remember a presentation I made called Evolution Works, a demonstration, and it's available on the internet in case you want to know. When evolutionists are forced to demonstrate adaptive pathways instead of just assuming them, the overwhelming evidence for evolution almost completely disappears. It started here, it got here, there must be a pathway, is the logic. If you say, no, you can't say there must be a pathway, what is the pathway? Or what are the pathways? However you want to put that. There are no pathways that are demonstrated, and it's just simply an assumption. There is an essential problem with the logic. It assumes that no designed events occurred. You see, if you start with here and you start with here and you say, well, it must have gotten from there and it didn't have any help, well, how do you know it didn't have any help? If this argument is used against intelligent design, it exhibits the flaw of assuming the conclusion. It turns out that there is almost no evidence for adaptive pathways working. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Did we bamboozle everybody?
Yes.
No, it's very interesting. Michael Behe made a statement way back in Darwin's Back Box that there are no demonstrations of viable evolutionary pathways, only a variety of wishful speculations. And that statement has been echoed now twice by people, James Shapiro back in the day when he made the statement, and I'm trying to remember the guy's name, Harold somebody or other, just a few years ago, sometime after the initial thing. And the fact of the matter is there are no, well, you need mutation A, B, C, D, and E, and they happen in this order, or they could happen in these five orders. You don't have that in the literature. And each one is adaptive, or between step two and three, you have to step down. You just don't have that kind of thing in the literature. And this is experimental evidence as to why you would find that kind of thing happening, where the problem is that you go into an unadaptive situation and the cell tries to find any way out of it can. And most of the ways it finds out of it are not going to be the way that you need to get to where you're going. And that's the problem, that evolution is blindly following the steepest hill it can to climb out. And the steepest initial hill may very well not be the hill that goes to the highest peak eventually.
Yeah, so the the way to approach when we talk about evolution and creation is to when evolutionists propose some just so story to describe how evolution works and why Darwinian evolution is what has saved science, basically, is to always ask, well, what's the mechanism?
That's right, because in their theory, there is always a mechanism, and it always must be natural and not guided.
Yeah, but it has to be a mechanism that works, or demonstrated to work.
Right. Otherwise, what you're saying is, well, it's a miracle, but there's no miracle producer. Now, see, we're not required to give a mechanism, because if you have a designer has multiple ways of doing it, some of which, in fact, in certain cases, probably all of which require mechanisms that are not well understood, and probably a few of them may not be well understood for eternity. But certainly, I mean, even if you think of it how we do it, I want a mutation in this particular base so that I can get this particular transformation from glutamic acid to valine. Well, it turns out that you need only one base change to get from glutamic acid to valine. So what you do is you deliberately construct exactly the DNA that you want to replace, but only with the new mutation in place. And then you try to heal it, and when it heals, it's going to change from either one to the other. And if it's the one, well, you're right back where you started from, but you have a 50% chance of getting to the mutation you want. And, you know, you do it in two of them, then you have a 75% chance that you got it. If you do it in four, you know, sooner or later you're going to get it. And see, that's not a... that is just one kind of design mechanism. And there are probably, you know, if you're inventive enough, there are probably hundreds of others. You have a special restriction nuclei, you know. And if you're God, you presumably could just simply go in there and tweak it.
Yeah, well, we have to have, for a natural explanation, a cause and effect relationship that you can point at through experimental observation and testing. When we throw God in, of course, that process hits a brick wall, and we can't go any further. So that's what upsets the scientific community, is that if we're going to throw a mind in there in this process, we're saying that science stops at that point.
And depending on how you define science, I would agree with you.
Yeah. But the way it's currently defined within the scientific community.
I agree. Yeah. There is one view of science that says if you don't have a mechanism, you don't have science. Now, I can think of, there's two questions is, one of them is, do you have a mechanism? And the other one is, this is actually an important theoretical point. One of them is, do you have a mechanism? And the second one is, do we know the mechanism? And the reason this is important is, right now, quantum mechanics is considered part of science. Nobody knows the mechanism. And, I mean, I can have lots of physicists that will tell you that. And so is quantum mechanics really part of science or not? I would prefer to define science as a study of the reproducible, in which case quantum mechanics is eminently reproducible. And therefore, it's still science even though we don't know the mechanism. And think of it this way. For 300 years, gravitation was considered part of science, although nobody had a clue as to what the mechanism is, including Newton himself. These things... You know, you have the three forces, which are kind of understood by, you know, particles hitting each other, bouncing off, whatever, you know. And they bounce depending on how much they weigh and all that kind of stuff. And then you have gravity, and that's a force that says something that's 5,000 miles or 50,000 or 500 million miles out is attracting this thing at something that is equivalent to this inverse square law. But Newton had not a clue as to how you get from 50 million miles away to your person or your planet or your whatever it is that you're attracting. And so that was science without a mechanism. And in fact, that's one of the things that Einstein finally did, was give a mechanism for gravitation. And he did it at the cost of opening up quantum mechanics, where we have no clue as to what the mechanism is. And in fact, I think most physicists would say, you know, there's a reason why we call it the theory of relativity. It sounds pretty good, but we don't know whether really that's how it works or whether really there is some kind of informational problem that's causing gravitation. And there are people now who are trying to use that to say, well, if you figure it this way, it'll give you the same results. Which means that we still don't know for sure the mechanism. But I don't think you can say there is no science because of that. So that's why, now mechanism is necessary for naturalism, because just to say, well, it happened, that's not exactly the way naturalistic science would like to portray things. It's really a well, as you probably know, the demarcation problem between science and non-science is a really thorny problem, with most philosophers of science saying that it has not been solved, and some questioning as to whether it can be solved. Comment here in just a minute. We're going to give you that.
Okay. So you said science needs a mechanism. Science should be reproducible.
Well, actually, he okay. did, but...
All right. So the question is, you know, there's so much environmental pressures that it cannot be reproduced in the laboratory. But again, these scientific experiments and conclusions seem to come to a conclusion, it's implausibility, because you're throwing the statistics. So statistics, in the end, so I want to say...
You have either... You have either impossibility or a statistical miracle.
So the question is Earth, in the universe of however many, you know, the bodies of, you know, planets or whatever, considering just using that statistic speaking, is the formation of Earth and the fact that the Earth is right now the only one that we found to be able to support life.
Yeah.
Is that is a scientific reason for Earth to support? Or it's just a mere it's a mere coincidence that Earth exists and not anywhere else. You know, so are we saying statistically speaking, it's not plausible for Earth to actually exist? Because is the Earth the existence of Earth to support life a mere coincidence because environmental pressure in the universe caused this particular one planet to have all the perfect condition to support life? Because you can't reproduce it. You can't. It's. I don't want to say you can't. It's statistically speaking, it's probably implausible.
I think you're right about that. Statistically speaking, it's implausible. And there are people who will argue from that set of facts to the idea that the Earth itself was planned. And, you know, it's interesting because the standard scientific community is coming very close to that at this point. The moon needed to be at a certain position in order for it to do certain functions. So how did the moon start? Well, actually, a Mars-sized body hit the Earth at just the right angle to cause just the right fog out there, which coalesced into a moon. I think now they're saying that it had to be mostly vapor because it spread so evenly. You know, what is the chances of that kind of a collision happening by just random planets flying into each other? It's got to be way down there somewhere. The Earth is either statistically rare. Or the other question is, maybe it was planned. And it doesn't matter whether it was planned by God who formed an earth and formed a moon and put them in and put the sun in place and all that, or whether God 3.5 billion years ago or 5 billion or whatever it is, caused a planet to hit at just the right angle. He was playing billiards and he's really good at it. You know, in either case, you're talking about something that happens that just shouldn't happen on its own. And once you have God in the mix, then, you know, that starts to make our security that science can explain everything a little bit insecure. Certainly naturalistic science can explain everything.
I won't agree with that, but on the other hand, they can't. The counterpart can also use that as a counter argument to say, the fact that Earth exists and ends up in having an environment to support life shows that by chance, all the things you said, how could they happen by chance? But they can say, well, by chance, this one planet in the universe, by chance, all the collisions that happened that never created a moon, never created the water vapor, never ever possible, but statistically speaking, one in the universe can't happen. So they, again, I'm not going back to this intelligent design and in the intricate details, but to say, people say, well, how did the first cell form? It was, they don't know. They say, well, but it was by chance. So how can we, again, going back and forth, it's the statistics that it's double-edged sword that we're both saying. We're saying, uh-huh. How could it statistically possible other than by intelligent design. But they say, well, it could statistically possible because one in the universe just happened this way. But because otherwise, you know, if it's by design, why couldn't we somehow locate something that with a similar environment without ability so far reach out in the universe and find something similar to Earth conditions?
Well, let me put it this way. It's not a completely compelling argument in that if you don't believe in this, you got to be just idiot. But I do think that you have to swim against the evidence. You know, we go exploring and we get to Alpha Centauri, which could happen in our lifetimes. You don't know. Okay, and we find a planet around Alpha Centauri. And as we're exploring the planet, we find this thing that looks like a machine that can fly. And as a matter of fact, we pour gasoline into it and push a button, and it starts moving its engines, and sure enough, the thing takes off. Now, if we find something like that, the question is, do we first attribute that to, it's amazing what volcanoes on planet X are, or do we say, somebody must have planned this. I don't know who. Maybe somebody was there before us that we don't know about. Maybe there was a civilization there, but this is not natural. You are not absolutely forced to believe that it's not natural. But you're pushed so close that at some point you got to say, you know, I really think that the most likely explanation is that somebody made this thing. Ariel?
Well, I just want to point out a favorite argument beyond this is, where did God come from? You say as a designer, where did the designer come from? And
well, that of course assumes that non-design was there in the first place.
Exactly.
Whereas it may very well be the design is the original.
The question of whether a designer designed is a different one than where did the designer come from.
Well, here's the thing, and this is important because this gets into what Richard Dawkins always ignores when he uses this kind of argument. Well, where did God come from? You know, and that is that. I don't know where God came from, or if he came from anything, if he's always been there. That's the easiest philosophical way to deal with it. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, if to put it this way, if an alligator is coming at you and you're in New York City, you don't say, well, that alligator can't be there. You look at it and you say, I'd better climb the stairs before he gets to me. You know, I mean, there comes a point where this is kind of fruitless. Let's supposing that it really is a brilliant graduate school in another universe that has created ours as a universe. Well, I think you better respect the brilliant graduate student, even if maybe you don't understand exactly how he's doing all this. You know, at a certain point, it becomes a practical matter that I don't understand how God came or whether he came or whether he needed to come at all, and he's always been there. But at some point, you say, you know what, there is a master intelligence, and then the only real question after that is this master intelligence somebody who is suffused with enough concern for his creatures that he's worthy of worship? Mm-hmm. That's the only real question after that. Because if he is, then we kind of have an intellectual and moral duty to worship him. If not, we're going to cry out against Zod or Cthulhu.
I would point out as a balance to the question, where is God? You know, where did he come from? You can ask the question, where did the universe come from? And you're stuck in the same area.
Well, the giant universe-making machine. And then the question becomes, who made the universe-making machine, and how does it work to create universes?
Sometimes I think our thinking is too simplistic to face the reality that we that's out there. How did anything get started? Cause and effect tends to fall apart there, I think, to a certain extent. We need to recognize that, although it works so nicely in science, especially, to have cause and effect.
Well, it does. Reproducible things usually have a reproducible cause. I guess with that, we will close, and we'll see you next week, and you get to hear a fresh face give you something. So hopefully you'll all be ready for somebody different than me. Okay. His title is Something from Nothing, and he's going to go through the claims that you can get something from nothing without something behind it. See, now, we see humans create something from nothing all the time, but it's not really something from nothing. First of all, we can't get back to no matter at all. But secondly, even if we could, there's always the human intellect that's involved in doing this. And so we don't really see something from nothing in the strictest sense of the word. We see something from creativity, from a being with creativity. And in the case of God, if God's there, then obviously he has the ability to create stuff from nothing. But the standard naturalistic way of looking at it is that there once was nothing, and then we got something from it. And I think we'll see what he does. I'm not sure exactly how he's going to take that, but he's probably going to take it in at least two different directions. One of them is the creation of the universe itself, but the other one will be the more than likely the creation of order and particularly complex, meaningful order in the universe. I'll put out what he has put out in a blurb. If you're getting the email, why you'll get that. And it'll be interesting to see what happens. Sean Pittman? He used to go to the Sabbath School before he moved up north to Reading or something like that. He's been all over the internet discussing the mechanism of evolution. And actually, if you go to, in the email, I actually have a link to his website. And he covers all kinds of things, sort of like I do. A little different emphasis, so you'll get some things in his that you won't get in mine, and vice versa. And if you read that, you'll get some flavor as to how he approaches things.